He is the Golden Globe and Emmy Award-winning actor who starred in everything from being a Bond girl to Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman. And now she's hitting our screens in a new Australian film called Ruby's Choice. Take a look.
If I'm going to paint, I'm going to need some inspiration.
Frank promised me that you'll always love me.
It's me, Tash.
It could be sundowners.
Well, that doesn't sound good.
What?
A baby.
What if it's hereditary?
It's not going to rain. Ruby!
How could you lose her?
And Jane Seymour joins us here live on the couch. It is so lovely to have you here.
It's great to see you again.
Well, I was lucky enough to be on set when you were filming Ruby's Choice. And it's wonderful that it's now hitting the big screen from next week here in Australia. It's an emotional journey, this film. Tell us a bit about Ruby.
So Ruby has a daughter and a granddaughter. It has a wonderful family, Australian family. They live. We shot this in Windsor. They're quite modest. And she has dementia, she has Alzheimer's, but nobody realises it. The family are in denial. They just think she's, you know, getting old or getting on or whatever. And but she doesn't realise that her husband passed a number of years ago. That, you know, that would be a dead giveaway, right?
Yes.
and she inadvertently burns down her house, and all kinds of things happen that eventually the family realises they not only have can be in denial about this, but what are they going to do about it? And she comes to live with them, and when she's there, it uproots and changes everything in the dynamic of the family, but actually in a very positive way. Mm-hmm. And so as devastating and as you know, touching and difficult as it is, this subject matter, something very beautiful comes out of it, something really amazing comes out of it. And it was just a wonderful emotional journey, an amazing role to play, and beautifully written. It was written by, you know, someone who actually works in that world. Yes. And I've shown this film to a couple of people who are in that world, you know, who work with people with dementia and have homes and things like that. And they just said, this is mandatory viewing for anyone that is ever touched by Alzheimer's or dementia, which, let's face it, I have yet to meet anyone that hasn't.
Exactly.
I mean, have you?
No, everyone is touched by it in some way.
Everybody.
And I know, for instance, the fabulous Glen Campbell documentary that was done on... knew him.
And... Very much so, yes. I mean, I made that I produced that as well. And I was on that journey, you know, for several years, and he was filming at my house. And we went on tour with him, and I was there at, you know, at the Grammys and everywhere. And, you know, one minute he didn't know where the bathroom was in his own room, his own, you know, bedroom, and or his wife or anyone. And then the next minute he'd be on stage singing Rhinestone Cowboy and just doing everything brilliantly. But then he'd repeat the song.
I know.
Straight away, and you'd go, oh, gosh, poor Glenn. Oh. But, no, it is it's a very cruel thing, but, you know, it's very interesting. One in two of us will have it. One in two. Mm. And at the moment there is no cure for it.
No.
So it really is an important subject. It can't be ignored.
It was wonderful to see you on set here in Windsor, just outside of Sydney, because it was during the pandemic. I think you were the only person allowed in the country pretty much at the time. And Australian crews were working. It was so exciting to see some of you. What was your experience like filming here?
Well, you know, first of all, no one could believe in America that, A, anyone of my age was going to have the lead in a movie, and, B, that I'd be doing it during COVID, and, C, that I'd be going all the way to Australia. But when I got here, they put me into isolation, and I had to do the quarantine, and that was brutal, I have to admit. But I'm also an artist, so I was painting and sticking my paintings on the wall. But the experience of working with those actors and with the crew and Michael Budd, who was terrific, was amazing. And especially in the 2 weeks before I came to work, I really got to know everyone on Zoom. So Jacqueline would, you know, she'd organise, she's very organised,
Jacqueline McKenzie.
Very organised, super organised. And she'd make sure we were all there, and we all got together and we rehearsed the living daylights out of this thing. I don't even think Michael knew, he wasn't there. We'd every two hours every day. And also we'd, you know, dish the dirt, you know, introduce one another to the cat or the kids or whatever was going on. So I felt like I knew these people when I came out, and when we were filming, the crew were fantastic, and, you know, it was a small budget movie, but with an enormous amount of heart and talent.
Yes, indeed.
Lot of talent.
Now, I can't have you sitting here on the couch without telling you that you are my favourite Bond girl of all time.
Oh, thank you.
And I can pretty much tell you that that opinion is shared by the gentleman monitoring the cameras today.
Oh,
you
good.
Can see lots
okay.
of nods going. Of course, you were Solitaire in
yes.
Live and Let Die with Roger Moore. Did that role change your life? Did it have a big difference? Make a big
well,
difference?
Well, I mean, unbelievable. I mean, you know, I was just a little girl from Merton Park, somewhere near Wimbledon. I'd gone to ballet school. I'd been a dancer and who had failed and became an actress by default. And I was doing a little series called The Enidan Line. And when the first episode came out, the Bond people said, "We want to meet her." I was unavailable. I met them a second time and they offered me the role on the spot. And, so Roger Moore, I had met him socially once because he was friends with my boyfriend at that time, was Michael Attenborough. And so when I actually went to play in the Bond film, he received a letter from Sir Richard Attenborough saying, "Please look after my daughter-in-law."
Oh, wow.
And he went, "Oh, that's a bit of a..."
I'm going to have to keep myself nice
yeah.
now.
It was a wonderful experience. I I'd never been to, Jamaica. I'd never been to New Orleans. I'd never been to America. No, I actually got arrested at one point for immigration. I don't know what's with me and immigration, but yeah, they said that I had a visa that allowed me to work in America, but not to transit. And I stupidly said to them, "Well, that's stupid. You mean I could actually go out and work now?" "Yes, you can, but you won't let me just go to the flight to Jamaica." And they actually arrested me. And then I said, "Do you like James Bond?" And they went, "Yes." And I said, "Well, you better let me go because otherwise it won't be a James Bond film." And they said, "Well, just this once."
Oh, okay. My God.
So that's how I got to
win. How to win over the immigration officials. Handy, handy
know,
to know.
Know.
My goodness.
Crazy.
You are one of the busiest women in Hollywood. You talk about your friends not believing you. You're in so many things. You're starring in a series called Be Positive. And this is a very different character. Take a look at this.
Looked like my daughter right before she went into rehab.
How kind of you to say.
Back in the day, I had a perfect hangover cure.
Oh, God, tell me.
Cocaine.
Thank you.
You're almost unrecognizable there. An amazing character.
So the brilliant Chuck Lorre, who's done every major comedy,
Two and a Half Men,
and all that, had hired me to do the Kominsky Method, which I had a wonderful character in that. And he called me and said, "Look, it's not a very big part, but it's really fun. I want you to be Bette. She's 85 years old. She's living in an old people's home, but she thinks she's a 20-year-old rock chick. And she is sort of the sexually active member of the community." So I mean, I had a blast with that.
Oh.
Yeah, and they had to age me, which was really funny. And they put these huge lashes on, and they I'd go in there and I'd go like this, and they'd find every wrinkle they could, and it was hilarious.
Oh, she's brilliant. And then you went to Ireland to make another series called Harry Wilde.
And I play Harry in that one. Harriet Wilde, actually, Professor Harriet Wilde, who was an English professor, and then she quits because she can do whatever she likes, and she thinks that students aren't really paying attention. And having been mugged and ending up at her son's house, her son's a detective, she, inadvertently looks at the paperwork and looks at the TV and discovers who the criminal is that had done this murder. And she inadvertently becomes a detective, a very good detective. But, it's very comical and fun. And people who've seen it, who've known me for a long time, say it's one of the best things I've ever done.
That's on Acorn TV,
which is
an app. And, that is ridiculously busy for anyone.
And, and that's my own series. I mean, who gets their own series at 70? Nobody. Angela Lansbury, maybe.
Did you imagine you'd be this busy still at this point in your career?
No. No. I thought, usually actresses, the sell-by date is, like, round about 40. But I got really lucky when I was 40. I got to play Dr. Quinn, so...
Well, let's
that
talk about
everything.
Dr. Quinn. Everybody loves Dr. Quinn. It was an extraordinary breakthrough. There you are, lead in a series on the telly.
Yes. Well, it was a great series, and it still plays so brilliantly today. It's in 98 countries. I mean, it's translated in every possible language you can imagine. And I think it's very interesting because it is Americana, but actually it's really what the world is all about now. It's about all these different cultures, all these different belief systems, all these people coming in to build this new country of America. I'm British in it, of course. No, actually, no, I play American from Boston. I forgot that bit. But, you know, the Chinese come in and African Americans have just been freed from being slaves. And, of course, the beautiful Joe Lando, who, if I post anything on my Instagram and with Joe Lando, that's just,
yes,
it goes completely nuts.
That's because people want to see this back again. I mean, we've seen some completely unnecessary things rebooted. This is necessary. We need Dr. Quinn back.
I know.
And Western's a flavour of the month at the moment. You've got Yellowstone.
We are so ready. So if anyone wants, we are ready. So Beth Sullivan, who created the original, has created the most incredible new series of Dr. Quinn, and it's brilliant. It's 30 years later, and now it's about us and the kids and the rest of it. And it's turn of the century. It's brilliant. But we went and we talked to one group. I can't remember who. We're still trying to get it done. And they said, no, it's too dusty. Westerns aren't in. Dusty.
That's what they call Western. The Power of the Dog is a Western, nominated for Best Picture.
And Yellowstone.
You know, Yellowstone and Seven, the prequels. And I think we need a worldwide campaign on that one. Now, you mentioned your Instagram.
Yes.
You have a lot of followers, but you've been posting some pretty... Look, can I show you in a swimsuit?
Oh, my gosh.
Look, can I just say, what is your secret? You look incredible.
Well, that's when I've been eating a lot in Thailand. I was in Thailand supporting an organisation called Freeland and trying to end pandemics. I actually did a PSA. It's going to be coming out soon. But, no, you know what? My kid took that photograph. My 26-year-old son, Johnny, took that photograph. I said, oh, take a picture of Mom. Mom. So, I don't know. I exercise a bit. I love food. I drink a little bit of wine, and I love life. And, yes, I was there with my grandchildren, and no makeup, on the beach.
Wow.
But thank you.
And these scarves, the one there...
Oh,
the one
these are, yes. So these are my paintings, my
art. Your artwork, just in case there was another talent that we needed to uncover.
If you go to JaneSeymour.com, you can see them. They're all there. This one says, if your heart is open, it will never stay broken. And this is kind of... Like, you see a heart here and flowers and... but we've got all kinds of scarves. I don't know how many now, about 20 or 30 different types. And I also do jewellery with open hearts and everything. Yeah. So I'm very busy. And then, of course, artwork. And I've got a monumental sculpture going up in Pittsburgh on Mount Olympus, as one does. Yes, big bronze. So I'm very interested in anything that's creative and especially something that can make a difference for people. So this is a sort of all about being inspired.
So retirement not on the cards, Ms. Seymour?
I don't think so. I mean... What would I do?
Exactly.
Play bad golf? I don't know. Actually, but I enjoy a little bad golf.
It has been such a thrill to have you here on Studio 10. Ruby's Choice is in cinemas on March 3rd. It's a must-see. Thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.